Right, so the countdown is on and the month is more or less done. The question is, are you still on the same targets that you set at the start of the financial year, or at the start of the year generally, or you are the ones that say you live each year that, or each day as it goes? I have friends who will tell you that for them, they only count that one day that they have lived because they're not very sure about the next days. But I also tell you that if you want to grow your finances and ensure that the things you do keep on track, then you might want to plan for how you live each day, because then that way you ascertain how much you're making, how much you're spending, how much you're saving, and all the possible risks that will come through. All right, so much happening in the world of business, from NSSF trying to ensure that there's compliance in the oil and gas sector, to coffee, the main value chain, a couple of people, you know, stakeholders, saying government needs to do more to unlock the potential in the coffee value chain. Welcome to the business show. My name is Simon. This is what's coming up on the show this week.
So when we apply the business model canvas to be able to understand better our food restaurant business, let's look at what are the key partners that we have for the food, for the food restaurant.
Once again, welcome to the show. From wherever you're watching, we are glad you could make time. Now, the show airs weekdays on Thursdays at 10 p.m. on Urban TV, and we do repeat on Saturdays at 8 in the morning. So always make a date and learn something from the experts that tell you the things you need to do to improve your business. Let's start the week with views from the top this week. And for those of you that have either been involved in accidents, or those that drive, or even walking by the roadside as a pedestrian, and you're involved in an accident, sometimes you're not very sure about what next if you have been knocked. Now, whereas other people will tell you that motor third party is a tax, it is not actually a tax. It is a policy or a cover that is supposed to protect you that is on the road. You are the third party, or the person in that car is the third party. This week on Views from the Top, we want to speak to Jennifer Achoko from GA Insurance, because we are talking why you need a valid motor third-party policy on your car, on your motorbike, and the benefits in the event that an accident happens. You actually don't have to run. There are procedures that you have to follow, and the affected will be compensated. This is how it's done, and this is Views from the Top this week.
Good evening, viewers. My name is Jennifer Achoko. I work with GA Insurance Uganda Limited.
Great stuff. So today's conversation will focus more on motor third-party insurance and what it covers. Let's start from there.
Okay, so motor third-party is your most basic insurance cover that is given to anybody that is operating a motor vehicle. It could be a car or a motorcycle. And the intention of this is to protect the road users from any accidents that may occur from you driving your car around.
So we now understand what motor third party insurance policy stands for and what it covers. So the next question should be, what is the process for a policy holder seeking to, let's say, file a claim?
So usually we'll advise insureds that when they do get an accident, the first point of call should be to inform your insurer that there's an accident that has been that has happened. So we'll then ask you to not admit liability at that point. Then we do come in. We usually send somebody to the scene of the accident, depending on how quickly you've reported, so that we are able to assess how much injury has been caused. Then we'll definitely give you some documentation to fill in and process the claim accordingly. Mm.
So sounds very basic, yeah?
Very basic. Okay. It is very basic.
This is an interesting question. Who is the third party?
So when we make reference to a third party, we are basically talking about a passenger in the car, a pedestrian moving on the road, or any property owner whose property gets damaged during an accident.
Mm.
Yes.
So how are they helped in case of an accident? Because let's say they are on the road walking and then they are knocked.
So like I said in my beginning statement, The third party basically covers injuries that are caused to a third party when an accident occurs. So whenever an accident occurs, it is assumed that the insured has a running policy. So you just look at the sticker, because we're required to display the stickers, so that should give you information on who the insurer is. Get in touch with the insurers, and we should be able to sort out any bodily injury that you have as per the limits stipulated on the motor insurance third party stickers. Okay. Yes.
So as an insurance company, at what point would you reject a claim?
Well, under motor third party, because the insured is an innocent motor road user, it is in a very rare occasion that you would expect to reject a claim, probably in incidences where there's fraud, but then this would not apply to the motor third party. So motor third party, in most cases, all claims are paid. Claims are paid.
I know you kind of mentioned something about filing claims, but what advice would you give to the viewers that most probably don't understand all these things we're talking about in regards to filing claims, or you have been knocked, you don't need to run away, you can actually be compensated?
Yeah, so I think it begins with, which is what we try to do on a daily basis, it begins with educating our road users. Like you've said, once you buy insurance, you've bought protection. And an insurance company is to come in whenever an accident has occurred. We never plan for accidents. So don't run away, don't be afraid. Just get in touch with your insurer. They should be able to come to the scene. Like I said, depending on how quickly you report, they should be able to assess the damage. If it's property damage, they should be able to assess the amount of injury. We actually even do hospital visits. We can recommend hospitals that we know, and we, with the purpose of ensuring that all medical bills and treatment are taken care of for the road user.
So with all the insurance companies in this country and the different stakeholders under the insurance industry, why do you think the uptake of motor third party by motorists still stays low?
So the insurance penetration level generally in this market is very low. It's just below 1%. And quite a number of reasons why you'll find a road user is running away is because they don't know what coverage they have. Truthfully, most people think that the third party is just a license that's required by government for you to display on your vehicle, but no, that's not the case. So that third party is your insurance coverage, and it is important to know what is covered, the limits that are covered under that third party, and exactly what is covered. So like I mentioned before, it covers bodily injury. The basic third party covers bodily injury that you may cause to the road users, up to a limit of 1 million per person and 10 million in aggregate.
Is motor third party a tax?
No, it is not a tax. It's not a tax, it's an insurance policy. It's the most basic insurance policy you can have.
So as GA Insurance, working with other stakeholders, like the Uganda Insurers Association, what are some of the things you're doing to create awareness?
So I would take this as one of the strategies that we use to create awareness. We like to do televised documentaries. We like to publish in the papers. We also do sensitization with some of the road users. Like, for example, we do sensitizations with taxi owners, because, you know, taxi owners and boarders, because these are the most frequent road users, and most times they're the ones getting involved in accidents. And quite a number of times, they are the group of people that do not know what their insurance covers. So we do sensitizations, we move around, and we try to educate them on what their insurance covers.
I would want to imagine that there's an issue of forgery of stickers. Is that something you guys experience, and how are you dealing with that?
Yes. In this market, there's lots of forgery on stickers, especially owing to the fact that we still do the hard copy stickers. But as an industry, we're trying to move to digitization of the motor third party stickers. We've already begun with having them done online, where for you to purchase a motor third party sticker, you have to make a payment through your mobile money platforms. It could be Airtel, it could be MTN. Once you make that payment, you get a reference number that you then go with to your insurer, which they are then able to use to generate or print for you a sticker. But then that, now what happens is all these records are kept on a database that is accessible by police. So it's very much easier to enforce. So if you have an insurance policy that is not registered online, it's considered as a fake.
Okay.
So that is really helping to improve.
All right. So I know there's many other products that probably, you know, GA offers.
Yes.
For people that don't have insurance covers yet, what are they missing?
Wow. Insurance is something that's generally been underrated by most people, but at the point at which you have a need, or at the point at which you get an accident or a fire and you really need to be put back to the position where you were, that's when you'll understand the importance of insurance. So we do have property insurance. We have insurance for the engineering classes. Those are your construction risks. We have more enhanced motor insurance, because we usually advise our insureds to move away from the basic motor third party, because then that doesn't cover your vehicle. But for you to have your vehicle covered, it's important to get a more comprehensive policy, which is the motor comprehensive insurance policy that extends to cover your vehicle against theft, fire, and any accidental damage.
Any parting shots from you?
From me would be to thank all our clients. To thank the public in general for being open to insurance. It is very important for each and every one of us to have our insurance needs catered for. And from us, it's just to promise that we remain here to serve you and to take care of all your claims.
Is insurance for the rich?
That is a myth that I think we should demystify at this point.
Mm.
Like we said, there are different categories of insurance. Like, for example, if we just talk about the motor, there's one, the most basic third party that we've just spoken about. Then there's the motor fire and theft. Now, this just covers your vehicle against specifically fire and theft. Then there's now the comprehensive. So depending on what your pocket looks like, you should be able to take up any of these covers.
Thank you so much.
So I guess you now understand that as a motorist, you don't have to run when an accident happens. Of course, there are circumstances, because sometimes it could be innocent and then guys are looking to lynch you or burn down the car. In those circumstances, you could run for your dear life. But if it's an accident that you think you're not in the wrong and there are probably police guys around, you don't need to run, because if you have a valid policy, then the people that are affected will be protected. We just thought it was important for you to understand that motor third party is meant to help you that is on the road, or you that is being given a lift in someone's car, okay? Of course, there is currently a review going on to push up this money from the current 1 million shilling, that is the fee that you can be compensated up to something reasonable, because look, the players are saying when the law was set in 1987, thereabout, you know, the money seemed much at the time, but over the years now, this money is little, so there's need to revise this. We hope you've learned something about valid motor third-party insurance and why you need to have it on your car or motorbike. You're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Time now for a quick break on the program. In the meantime, feel free to get in touch with us on our socials. Listen, there's a conversation about fuel prices, and I tell you what, my God, it's what, 5-3 now? Almost every second you turn your head off a petrol station, Mark, the moment you turn back, the price is up again. There was a talk about the fact that there is a stop from supply within Saudi Arabia. I hope this can be addressed. And I was just thinking to myself, I wish we can push 2025 so soon so we can start producing our own oil. Maybe we can have the fuel prices drop. I don't know how realistic that is, but yeah, we hope optimistic that this should be able to help us. Yeah, let's take a break. I'll see you shortly. Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Now, this story of Kenya Airways net loss, you know, widening to Kenya shillings 21.7 billion. I don't know, but, you know, I know this is a national carrier, yes, but over the years, these guys have been making losses. And almost every time we have a story about Kenya Airways, it is a loss. I don't understand the business sense of this, but like I said, it is a national carrier, or it's a national business, I should be saying, yeah? So maybe the guys behind it are saying, we shall make money. We shall make some money one day. So let's just keep pushing on. But as a business person, the talk is, if your business is not nationally owned and you're an individual and you are running it, but you're not making that money from the time that you anticipated, are you going to keep saying, let's just keep putting in more money, one day we'll make the profits, or you need to re-strategize to see how you can improve your business? That is what we want to look at this week in How to Make Money. And these are the basics that you need to understand to help you run your business successfully.
Hassan Mkasa is my name. I'm the managing director of a reliable furniture enterprises. This is a furniture company doing local furniture, especially MDF. MDF is wood actually made here by one of the companies, one of the Indian companies, Nairoply, based in Nakasongola. That wood of MDF has made this work easy, because it is already finished. Leave alone the other raw one you are making of whatever mahogany, musambia. It was taking a lot of time, but MDF, it has already a coating that is finished. All we do is finishing the edges. So in that way, we don't waste customers' time. Customers can actually take their orders instantly. I can tell someone can give me a big order and I process it in just 2-3 days. And that has really picked the image of this business, because you know in the past, the image of carpenters was really tarnished, because they were delaying people's work, they were going away with their monies. You know, they were not fulfilling on their promises. Yeah, there are people who prefer that type of furniture, but now Chinese furniture has taken the market, and Chinese furniture was mainly MDF. It had taken the market, and they were not doing it different from the way we are doing it. And when we look at the market, ideally 90% are satisfied with this kind of MDF wood. Yeah, and I think if we can go with the 90%, that business is already enough. I realize we are doing good things. People would commit, they would come with the few products that we had. I realized we are doing good things. So I moved around, because actually one of the problems that we have in furniture is organization. This is informal. We are in an informal sector. It is basically everyone for himself and God for us all. in furniture. Someone just wakes up and sets up somewhere, and they see how they thrive through it. So I said, no, I'm not going to do this. I have to. I looked around for associations of furniture, but I wasn't getting any. So I moved around till a friend of mine told me, you can move to Uzia, maybe they can help you. I moved, that is Uganda Small Scale Industries Association. So I moved to Uzia, I inquired. They told me you are welcome. They told me about their modalities of membership and all that. I told them, I'm okay with it to be a member, because I want to be with you guys such that I can promote myself, such that I can, such that my products can do what? Can move. So that was 2018. Then 2019, we were able to exhibit in that international trade fair in Uma, behind Uzia. They actually gave us space in their boardroom. That's where we exhibited. So when we exhibited there, we put our products there and we got good comments. And that gave us the courage that at least we have a product. Now we need what? The market. So we come back. Some of the contacts we've got, people would come to our showrooms, they would buy, they would make them repairs, that kind of thing. So we got courage to move on. Then 2019, we were able to incorporate in the wooden furniture, mainly office and domestic furniture. Down the road, that was Feb, then March, we went in a lockdown. And we had made some of the products in display. So we had to look back, and we had to think more how we could move on. We had done good PR, we had done good promotion. We had to go online to promote our Facebook page, promoted it. We had to move. These days there are online business sites like Gigi, like Jumia. So we had to go to those ones and ask for their help. Good enough, they honored us. They honored us, we were able to put our products there, and we've continued to actually do business even in COVID time. Yeah, people would order online, then we deliver, they pay us on delivery. We've found a competitive advantage in that, because many carpenters, when they tell them you deliver then I pay you, they have that fear that maybe I'm going to deliver and this guy is going to clone me. But for us, we are not about that, because we know we are confident of what we've made, we are confident of our quality. So there is no reason why I should get scared of someone telling me that deliver and I pay you on delivery.
Well, I guess it's clear for you then there that there are some principles that must be followed for you to make your money, in how to make money. More episodes to come in the subsequent shows, so feel free to get in touch with us in case you need connections to the guys that we have aired, because, I mean, like I keep saying, we are here to help you improve your business. So if we can connect you up with the people that are making it successfully, then be more than glad at the end of the day. Let's then talk you through personal finance tips for this week. And we are talking the second episode now with the CEO of Med Business Consult, Enoth. And this week we are talking about how vital partnerships are in that business model that you are taking. This is personal finance.
Hello, good evening viewers. Welcome to yet another session of the Business Show here on Urban TV. My name is Enoth Mbeino, your business coach. Last week, we were able to cover the highlights of what a business model canvas looks like, and we're able to see that it has 9 building blocks. But this week, like I'd promised, I want us to dive deeper and dwell into some of these key blocks. I'm going to use an example this time to be able to explain in detail what some of these blocks are. It could be a different business that you're doing out there. It could be a saloon. It could be a stationery shop. It could be a tailoring business. It could be anything else. But for purposes of learning today and this particular week, let me take an example of a food restaurant. So with a food restaurant, let's analyze it using the business model canvas. So when we apply the business model canvas to be able to understand better our food restaurant business, let's look at what are the key partners that we have for the food restaurant. One, we shall look at the distributors. For example, if we have a restaurant and we need to take food to our clients, who are going to be our distributors? So these are our key partners, because we really depend on these people. Secondly, we can look at the KCCA. KCCA offers the regulator, is the regulatory body. It gives us the licenses. If it inspects the health condition of our restaurant, so that's a key partner. If they cancel our license, we shall not be able to operate. So KCCA is a key partner. Another key partner that we can analyze with the food industry is the food suppliers, the food vendors, the people where you go to buy the food from. Those are your key partners, because if they are not there, your business will not survive. Is it the food suppliers in Owino Market, in Kalere Market, in Nakawa Market, where you buy the food to cook for your restaurant? These are very important key partners, the food suppliers. National Water and Sewerage Corporation. When you're cooking, you use a lot of water. And once your water is switched off, you're going to suffer. So National Water is a key partner. You need to make sure that you pay their bills and make sure that you're in the good books for National Water. The other example of a key partner that you probably need is umeme, because it provides power and you need power in a food restaurant. Let's quickly go to our next block and apply it to our example of the food restaurant. The key activities. What are your key activities? What are the key activities of a food restaurant? So when I explain some of these blocks, please try to also see how you can apply them in your business. So what are your key activities? For the key activities of the food restaurant, we can say marketing, selling, the actual cooking itself, and also branding of your company. So these are some of the key activities. Key activities are the things that you do on a daily for your business. And lastly for today, let us look at customer segmentation. Customer segmentation is, how do you prepare a product for which market? So if we look at the example, our example of the food restaurant, who will be our customers? What will be our customer segmentation? Are you going to sell your food to the corporates? Are you going to sell your food directly to the households? Are you going to sell your food to the schools, hospitals, or the various traders? How can you make sure that you divide and be clear of which customers that you are serving? So this is a very good example of segmenting your market to be able to understand your market better, so that you serve it better.
Well, so I did talk about the fuel prices a bit early on the show, but you know what? I still think that maybe we need to have solutions, because if anything is to go by, should the prices keep going up, we know what that means. The cost of almost everything that is transported will go up, okay? So the guys in the market will tell you, well, the prices have gone up. We have nothing we can do. We only have to increase the prices to make up on the losses that we're incurring as we transport this. 5,300 and over is not good enough. We hope that maybe at the start of, by the start of next month, things will, you know, go down a bit so we can have something that is fairly okay for the markets. Talking markets, this is now the comprehensive report of the Forex and money markets. So, after the recently concluded G25 African Coffee Summit, or dialogue that happened here, there was a post-dialogue meeting by Eswatini and other partners, and the talk was about how they can unlock the potential of the coffee farmers, mostly the small and medium players in this sector. There was a whole conversation here that had stakeholders from the guys, the farmers themselves, the policymakers, Uganda Coffee Development Authority, and of course there was an agreement that the government has the key role to take on to ensure that the potential is unlocked. We await to see how that unfolds. Plus, NSSF trying to encourage more people. A six-month ultimatum has been set, so by Feb next year, if the players in the oil and gas sector are not compliant, then an iron hand will be laid onto them. Again, we await to see how that is unfolding. I'm not very sure about how you're doing with your business, but I hope you're keeping track of what is working and what is not working. We hope you improve. My name is Simon. That's all we have time for on the show this week. Thank you so much for making time. Feel free to get in touch with us on our socials. We'll be more than glad to respond. From me and the rest of the team here, it's bye-bye. We'll see you soon.